Well, good morning and welcome to our Resurrection Sunday celebration. I invite you to join me in standing as we sing and worship the Lord together. Number 239 in your hymnal, or look to the screen. In Christ alone, my hope is found. Sing it out with me, would you?
In Christ alone.
To our Resurrection Sunday service, and we're glad to have each one of you here. We're looking forward to a good service. This is the third time I've gotten to hear it, and I'm excited. I'm looking forward to it, and so I hope that you are as well. The choir and the orchestra are not here to perform. They're here to present. They're to present worship to God and present Jesus Christ to you and I. And so we would ask that you not clap for them during the presentation, but just enjoy and be blessed by what they have to share with you. And we're looking forward to just a good time together in the Lord. Let's bow for prayer. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be here this morning on Resurrection Sunday. This is the day that we celebrate the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ. We celebrate his love for us and the fact that he lives today. And Lord, we pray that each person would be blessed by the song and the videos and the preaching, and you would speak to our hearts. And that we might see Christ. For it's in his name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Fear ye not, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come, see the place where the Lord lay. casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you.
Some say that you knew Jesus of Nazareth, that you met him.
Yes, that is true. I did meet him. More appropriately, he met me.
Really? What's he like?
Regardless of what others may say about him, I know this. I know that he cares, because he cared for me. I was completely unable to walk. I had been that way for 38 years. I had heard of the healing powers of the pool called Bethesda in Jerusalem, and so I was taken there. And there I waited. I waited in that miserable place surrounded by a great multitude of blind, lame, withered. I was waiting for a miracle. I was at the very edge of giving up hope.
Peter, why are we here? It's not safe. We could get some kind of disease.
He insisted on us coming. Perhaps we'll get to see the troubling of the waters.
The what?
The troubling of the waters. They say that an angel comes down and stirs the waters, that whoever steps in first is healed from whatever disease he has.
Who's he talking to now?
Why do you lay here? Won't you be made whole?
Sir, I have laid here for many years, longing to be made whole. But I have no man to help me in the water when it's stirred. Before I can enter, another goes in before me.
Rise. Take up your bed and walk.
I know that he cares. He cared for me. He met my needs when I thought there was no hope.
To the broken, close to the weary of heart. In his name is a refuge, safety for the weak and discarded. There is help for the hopeless, for the in the presence of Jesus, there is power unleashed. Call upon the name of the Lord. He's our defender, our deliverer, a shelter in the midst of the storm. Jesus, our Savior. Shelter in the midst of the storm.
is the Lord Almighty.
Cares. That's the message we want you to hear today, is Jesus cares. The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 7, casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. And the story you saw in the video, the story of the man with the paralyzation that was raised up and walked, the story is in John chapter 5. In verse number 1, it says, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. In these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, a blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first after the troubling of the water stepped in was made whole of whatever disease he had. And a certain man was there which had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he saith unto him, Wilt thou be made whole? The impotent man answered him, Sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool. But while I am coming, another steppeth down before me. Jesus saith unto him, Rise, take up thy bed, and walk. And immediately the man was made whole and took up his bed and walked, and on the same day was the Sabbath. As I listen to that story, it reminds me that when I was a teenager, probably about 14 or 15 years old, I went down to the American River in California. We went out as a group of friends to go swimming, and we were at this area. It was right next to a bridge across the river, and right next to it, there was this rock, this cliff that was about 25 or 30 feet high, and you could jump off of the water. It was deep enough, you could jump off into the water. And so my friend said, well, let's go over there, and I said, okay. And we all went over there. Now, you have to understand, I do not like heights. I'm just not the kind of person that likes to get up and jump off of things that are more than just a few feet high. And so when we went there, I told all my friends, you guys can jump, I'll just watch. And when we got there, I was watching them jump off the cliff. And then after a while, they said, hey, surface, come on, you can do it. I said, no, I don't want to do it. They said, come on, you can do it. I said, no, I don't want to do it. And then they said, one more time, well, you can do it. And one of the people that said that was this pretty little girl. And I liked her. And I thought, I'm going to impress her. I'm going to do it. And so I got up, and I went over to the edge of that cliff, and I looked down over the edge, and it was like 1,000 feet down. And folks, I was paralyzed with fear. I stood there at the edge of that cliff, and I could not move. I just couldn't jump, but I couldn't turn around and go back either. I was just paralyzed, stuck there. And I didn't know what to do. And finally, one of my best friend, Max, he saw that I was in trouble, and like a good friend, he thought he'd help me out. So he came over and put his arm around me and said, hey, Surface, what's wrong? I said, Max, I can't jump. I'm too scared. But I don't want to go back either. He says, don't worry. This is what friends are for. He says, I'm here with you. And he reached over and put his arm around me and pushed me. Sometimes you don't need a man to help you. Jesus is not going to push you, but he is here to help you. The Bible says in Luke chapter 19 and verse number 10, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. He came to help you with your need, just like he helped this man with his need. He is your friend. The Bible says in John chapter 15 and verse number 13, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his brother. And Jesus came and died because he's your friend. He came and died because you have a need just like this man. You have a disease. His disease was being paralyzed. You and I were paralyzed with sin. In Romans chapter 3 and verse 23, it says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And that includes everybody in this room. You may not have some of these other diseases described in this passage, but you've got a disease that paralyzes you, that disease of sin. And the only one that can cure that disease is the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, don't wait for religion to take care of that disease. This man for 38 years had sat by that water hoping that getting in the water would cure him. And I'm here to tell you that the water of baptism will not cure that disease. Neither will catechism or church membership. Religion will not solve your problem. Rituals will not take care of your problem. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, for by grace are you saved through faith, and then not of yourselves. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. In Titus 3, 5, it says, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he has saved us. And so there is none of these things that can cure you of your disease of sin. You need Jesus to help you. You need Jesus to take care of this need in your life. Not only does Jesus want to help you, but we want to help you as well. There's a story in Acts chapter 8 about a man the Bible calls the Ethiopian eunuch. And he was riding his chariot, reading his Bible. And it says in verse number 30, and Philip ran thither to him and heard him read the prophet Esaias and said, understandest thou what thou readest? He said, how can I, except some man should guide me? And he desired Philip that he would come and sit with him. And in verse 35, then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. And folks, we want to show you in the Word of God how God can take care of your need. In Romans 10, 17, it says, faith come by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. In 1 John chapter 5 and verses 12 and 13, the Bible says, he that hath the Son hath life. He that hath not the Son of God hath not life. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God. And through God's word, you can know that your sins are forgiven. You can know that you're on your way to heaven. You can know that you have eternal life. We're here today to tell you that Jesus cares.
Herein is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins.
Laban, Laban, I've met him. The teacher, the one we've been waiting for. Come, meet him, see him, talk to him.
You're crazy, Fotina. The sun is getting to you.
Laban, listen to me. Come meet a man who told me everything I ever did. Is not this the Christ? The Messiah? I met him just a few minutes ago when I went to draw water from Jacob's well.
Please, give me something to drink.
Sir, how is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a woman of Samaria?
If you knew of the gift of God, and who exactly it is that asked you a drink of water, you instead would have asked me, and I would give you living water.
Sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. How exactly would you give me this living water?
Well, if a man were to drink of this water, then he will surely thirst again. But if he drinks of the water that I give, he will never thirst. But it will spring up into him life eternal.
Sir, give me this water, that I may drink and no longer thirst, so I no longer have to come here daily to draw from this well.
Well, first, go. Call your husband and tell him to come.
I have no husband.
It's true. For you have had 5 husbands, and the man that you're currently living with is not your husband.
Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Well, if you are a prophet, then tell me. The Jews say that we are to worship God in Jerusalem, and our fathers tell us that we are to worship him here, in this mountain.
Look, I didn't come to argue points of religious tradition. True worshipers will worship the Father from one location, their heart, in spirit and in truth.
I know that when our long-awaited Messiah comes, he will teach us all these things.
I that speak to you am he.
I believe. He is different, Laban. He is more than a teacher. No matter what your story is, he loves. And in his love, there's forgiveness, and mercy, and hope.
Blessed are you as you weep on your knees, with perfume and tears washing over my feet. Blessed are you, beggar, hopeless and blind, calling for mercy when I'm passing by. Blessed are you, shaking your head, tiny fish and some bread. to show you what love sees when I see you.
But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. And with his stripes, we are healed.
Dying for me. Blessed.
Jesus loves. That's what today is all about. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. There is no greater love than a man lay down his life for his brothers. We saw just a moment ago the video about the woman by the well. In John chapter 4, in verse number 4, it says that he must needs go through Samaria. Jesus didn't have to go that way, but he chose to. Samaria was the land of half-breeds, people that the Jews despised, and yet Jesus loved them. And he went out of his way to tell this woman about her need. Jesus loved her, even though she was a sinner. In John chapter 4, verses 16 through 18, it says, Jesus saith unto her, Go, call thy husband and come hither. The woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said unto her, Thou hast well said, I have no husband. For thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou now hast is not thy husband, in that thou saidest truly. In today's world, having five husbands is no big deal. But in that day, it was bad. And now she was living with a man who wasn't her husband. Some Bible scholars believe she was possibly even a prostitute. Yet none of that mattered to Jesus because he still loved her. And he told her about his love. She was a religious woman too. In John chapter 4, verse 19, the woman saith to him, Sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain. You say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus saith to her, Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when you shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Later on, he says, We worship the Father in spirit and truth. Your religion is not going to get you into heaven. I don't care whether it's the Baptist religion or the Catholic religion or the Lutheran or Buddhist or whatever religion it is. No religion is good enough to get you into heaven. You need a relationship with Jesus Christ. You need to know him as your personal Savior. He loved you. In Romans chapter 5 and verse number 8 says, But God commendeth or showed his love towards us in that while we're yet sinners, Christ died for us. God loved you no matter where you're coming from, no matter what you've done, no matter what your past. He loves you and died for you personally. We're here today as Christians because he loved us. 1 John 4:19, we love him because he first loved us. And I hope if you leave here with nothing else today as a Christian, you will leave here with a renewed love for the Savior who would suffer what he suffered and die on the cross for you and for me. Jesus loves.
The Bible tells us that on the first Easter morning, three women went to the tomb of Jesus Christ to look for him there. When they arrived, they did not find the body of Jesus, but instead they found the stone rolled away and an angel who greeted them by saying, He is not here. For he is risen, as he said. Today we're not gathered to remember the death of Jesus Christ or even what it did for us. We're here to celebrate his resurrection. He conquered death. Would you stand and join me in the choir in singing number 325 in your hymnal or look to the screen. Christ arose, low in the grave he lay, but he arose. Sing it out with me.
Low in the grave he lay, Jesus my Savior.
Death cannot keep its prey. Jesus.
Why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen.
Peter, I've heard you preach now many times with great power. Part of me wants to believe, to follow Jesus, but things hold me back.
What things, Micah?
Things in my past. Disappointments, frustrations. You wouldn't understand.
Well, I understand. There was a time after Jesus was arrested outside of Pilate's court, but I denied him.
You think that's right? I think we know you. You're one of Jesus' disciples.
No, you must be mistaken.
No, you're right. You're one of the followers of Jesus.
I do not know the man.
Why, you're one of his followers.
I do not know this man of whom you speak.
Then they took him. And they crucified him. And when he died, all of my hopes and dreams died with him. I had been with him for nearly every day for 3 years. I had thought I would rule and reign with him as a king. Was left with nothing.
So what did you do?
I went back to my old life. I went back to fishing.
But his followers, and even you, say he's not dead, that he was raised again.
That's right, Micah. 3 days later, we heard the news. I saw the empty tomb. But I was still so ashamed. I knew he could never use me again. So I just went back to fishing. And then, one day he came to us.
Peter, do you love me?
Yes, I do.
Peter, do you love me?
Yes, Lord. I love you.
Simon Peter, son of Jonas, do you love me?
Lord, you know all things. You know I love you.
Peter, I'm not through with you. You still have much value in my kingdom and for my cause.
It was then I realized that he lives. And because he lives, he offers us new life. Because he lives, we no longer have to carry the burden of our past. Because he lives, he offers us a new start. New purpose and a new life.
Freedom's calling, chains are falling, hope is dawning, bright and true. Day is breaking, night is breaking, God is making. Hear the heart of heaven beating,
Jesus lives. That's what today is all about. We're not just celebrating the death of Christ upon the cross. That shows the love of God. But we're celebrating the resurrection because that shows the power of God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 4, the Bible says, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, the good news, which I preached unto you, which also you have received, and wherein ye stand. By which also you are saved, you keep in memory what I preached unto you, lest you believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the Scriptures." Today is Resurrection Sunday. That's the power of God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse number 14, it says, "If Christ be not risen, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is also vain. Yea, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up, if so be that the dead rise not. For if the dead rise not, then is not Christ raised. And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain, you are yet in your sins. Then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. In this life only, if we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable." I am thankful that the story does not end with Jesus upon the cross, but it ends with an empty tomb. It ends with the resurrection, because that's what this is all about. Because of the resurrection, we have victory today. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse number 55, it says, "O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." And I love this next verse. "Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord." The story of the resurrection is for those of you that are not saved to know that Jesus can save you and give you eternal life. But for those of us that are Christians, the resurrection is so much more. The resurrection means forgiveness of sin. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sin according to the riches of his grace. The resurrection means peace with God. In Romans chapter 5 and verse 1, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith in the grace wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of glory. The resurrection is what gives us new life in Christ. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. In the resurrection, I have an advocate with the Father, Romans 8:34. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Because of the resurrection, I have hope. 1 Peter 1:3 says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. It's because of the resurrection that I have power. In Philippians chapter 3, verse 10, it says that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings be made conformable unto his death. Paul was already saved. He knew he was going to heaven. He'd already trusted Christ as a Savior, but he understood that there's power in the resurrection. And he said, I want that power in my life as well. But you need to believe. If you're here today and you're not saved, you need to believe in Jesus Christ. The Bible says in Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God is raised from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. In Romans 10:13, it says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And today on Resurrection Sunday, on Easter Sunday, you can call upon Jesus Christ. Ask him to come into your heart and life and take away your sins and give you eternal life. You can believe in him today. In the story of the Ethiopian eunuch in Romans chapter 8, verse 37, it says, and Philip said, if thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Will you believe on him today? And then for you and I as Christians, would you believe in the power of the resurrection? In Ephesians chapter 1 and in verse number 7, the Bible says, Ephesians 1:17, says that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what the riches of the glory of the inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places. For those of you that are Christians today, I hope that you will leave here realizing the power of God that dwells in you. The same power that raised him from the dead is the power that God gives to you to live the victorious Christian life every day. And we ought to praise God for that power.